Faces, friends, places, years and moments half forgotten, laughs, fears, songs, and tears. Memories are made of this. I remember how cold it was in Britain that winter of 1929. Cold and wet, with far more than its share of snow. I know, what winter isn't? Fog and sea mist around a house on the front at Bognor. Us with a guarding policeman under constant watch. I remember the London crowds outside Buckingham Palace, waiting for news. Lung trouble, the doctors had said. The bulletins. A fresh improvement in the general condition, signed Lord Dawson of Penn. Then that closed car moving down the wet lanes towards the south coast, towards that house at Bognor, where King George V was to convalesce. Cold, wet and foggy, in somber mood. The same old London being true to form. No weather in which to march to London from South Wales when your boots were thin and your stomach was empty. Hunger marches, signs of the political times. Times when, as always, it seemed that no party had the power to make life acceptable to everybody. I remember a new British government having its face photographed in the garden of No. 10 Downing Street, the way they all did. The second Labour government in British history. Prime Minister, yes, that's it, Ramsay MacDonald. As the Colonel said, socialists, and a damned peculiar colour at that, with five lords and a viscount in the cabinet. A new government with plenty to face, small majority. Unemployment around the million mark and all that goes with such a situation. Yes, they could smile. For the camera, anyway. London in 1929. Closed-top buses fighting and winning their battle against the open-tops. Plenty of the old type still about, though. I remember reading Edgar Wallace on one of those and pulling the tarpaulin cover over me when it rained. That was the kind of discomfort you took no notice of in those days. There were fewer cars and therefore more feet on the pavements. Though whether life moved at a slower pace is a moot point. They brought in a gadget called the tote that year. Very popular too, except with the bookmakers. Bets on the machine were cheap then, but as you didn't get paid so much money, I don't suppose there was a lot in it. As for the clothes, they tell me that many of the fashions of that time are back again. Well, if that's true, you can take it that these are the real originals. They don't look very different, but... or do they? England won the Ashes in 1929, and every Englishman knows what that means, even if he doesn't play cricket. Major Seagrave broke the world's land speed record at 232 miles an hour. On the other hand, Malcolm Campbell, going all out with his Bluebird in South Africa, found his luck against him. Even in those days, enthusiasts roared up and down the streets of Monte Carlo in the Monaco Grand Prix. So bit early for him, but all the same, a British team won. Two bright boys crossed the channel on a motorbike. That is one way of doing it. While two other characters paced it out to Vienna on stepladders. The exact reason for this escapes me. Then someone brought out a two-way car. Somebody else achieved a lifetime ambition to fly into a house at 70 miles an hour. A steamroller that went by itself. Went is the word. It hasn't been seen again since. But there were more successful achievements. A scientist developed a new drug. Its name, penicillin. His name? Fleming. Muffled drums across the channel in Paris. Bad weather again, giving the right touch to a funeral. Marshal Foch, ex-commander-in-chief of all the Allied armies in the Great War. Who says old soldiers never die? Bietigon, Haig, Jellicoe. Now it was Foch. Biggest man of the biggest war. Perhaps that's why some didn't feel as badly about it as they might. Because burying Foch seemed somehow like burying the war. Well, he's gone, they said, the way they do. The Great War was 10 years over. The war was just memories and a play called Journey's End and scrap in Scarpa Flow where the German fleet was so much rust and barnacles. Scuttle rather than surrender, they'd said back in 1919, and they'd gone down in minutes. Took years to get them up. Get them up just to melt them down. It was strange what came up with them. A ship is so much those who sailed in her. Their possessions, their treasures. From tubers to swords. Swords for turning into plowshares. The war was 10 years over, but they still had to have a few swords of a kind. The cavalry giving way to, what was the term? Armored vehicles. Quite a blow to some on the retired list and others still in the service. But fashions must change or they wouldn't be fashions, even in the army. And armies were still in fashion. Armies and monarchies. There were still enough kings and princes left in Europe for a deck of cards. King Boris of Bulgaria. Kings and princes in such countries as Yugoslavia, Albania, Romania, and Italy. But who's that under the bowler? Friend or foe? In those days, no one seemed quite sure of Benito Mussolini. All I use is a touch of garlic, but what was cooking was anybody's guess. Mind you, there were a few surprises under other saucepan lids, too. To most people, the Schneider Trophy was just an international air competition. But that shape, winning for Britain against Italy, that was the shape that one day would save a world.
and trainers were unable to send their charges for gallops in the usual training grounds. Instead of frostbound fields, some of the entries for the Grand National found themselves galloping over the sands at Bognor. Rather humiliating for a thoroughbred to have to give an imitation of a donkey ride. But of course there's nothing common about it now that it's called Bognor Regis.
The surface is frozen over, adding a certain weirdness to the already strange beauty of the Fen country. A house with a memory is about to be demolished. Here in the sea air and sunshine at Bognor Regis, King George V was nursed back to health after his severe illness in 1929. Efforts to preserve it were unsuccessful, and the owner prefers that Craigwell House should be demolished rather than allow some new use to cloud its associations.
Regis has a new laundrette run by some very familiar characters, the Hulbert family. Cecily Courtage is first on the scene on opening day, with husband Jack Hulbert close behind, and to judge by the public interest, there aren't going to be many empty machines. But hold on a minute, Cecily's making a speech.
And the third reason, and the most important reason, now listen to this carefully, the reason why you should come to this laundrette is that it will help to keep the Hulberts in their old age. Uh-huh. And when I say old, I am not referring to myself at the moment. I'm talking about years ahead. Well, anyway, I hope it's going to be an enormous success, and I am now going to declare it open.
Hooray!
Now then, here we go. I'm now going to do this right. There. Fine. Now give me the laundry. Come on, very important. Come on, open it. There we are. Jolly nice quiet pajamas. Now, in they go, in they go. Wait a minute. Right. There they are. A few more of the smalls, we'll go to that anyway. There they are, jolly fine. Right, now then, all ready, all set for the great moment. Now then, put them on!
particularly, it's often difficult to know where fantasy leaves off and reality begins, and that indecision can spell danger, which is why, of course, children in a pool like this have to be watched at all times. However, at this holiday camp at Bognor, they've eased the problem by not only having glass sides, but a glass bottom too. One needs to be a parent, of course, to appreciate the sheer luxury of being able to sit down in a restaurant without Junior bouncing up and down on your knee.